Hello, in this episode we're going to be looking at the four different types of loops. Let's start with the most common one, the for loop. To create a for loop, we write the keyword for, followed by a pair of parentheses, and then a pair of curly brackets. Now, inside the parentheses, we have three sections separated by semicolons. The first is the initializer, the second is the condition, and the third is the iterator. The initializer section is where we create a local variable, usually an integer, which is conventionally called I, but you can make it anything you want, of course, and we initialize that to some value. In the condition section, we then state the condition that must be true in order for the loop to run. So for example, we might say run while I is less than 10. Finally, in the iterator section, we can modify the value of our variable. So for example, we might have i++, meaning that I increments by 1 each time. Between the two curly brackets, we then have the body of our loop, which I'll make simply print out the value of I. If we run this code now, we'll see that it prints out the values from 0 to 9. So if we think through this step by step, it should be clear how the loop works. First, the variable I is created and set to 0. The condition I less than 10 is true at that point, so the code in the body of the loop runs once, printing out 0. Then the iterator section runs, increasing the value of I from 0 to 1. The condition is still true, so the code runs once again. This repeats until I is increased to 10, at which point the condition is no longer true, so the loop terminates and the code resumes running from outside the loop. This sort of loop is often useful for setting the values in an array. For example, if we're wanting to store, say, the first 20 powers of 2, we could create a new integer array with a size of 20, and then loop from int I equals 0, while I is less than powersof2.length increment I by 1. Remember that since arrays are indexed starting at 0, their last element has an index of 1 less than their length, which is why we have the loop run while I is less than powersof2.length, and not while I is less than or equal to powersof2.length. Now, inside the loop, we can simply have powers of 2 with an index of I is equal to 2 to the power I, using the mathf.pow method. Of course, we don't have to start the loop at 0 and increment by 1 each time, although that is how it's usually used. As an arbitrary example, we could initialize int I equal to 100, and then while I greater than negative 80, decrease I by 30. Alright, now how about looping through multidimensional arrays? Say we have an 8x8 integer array representing a chessboard, and we want to set it so that light squares have a value of 0 and dark squares have a value of 1. To achieve this, we can use two nested for loops. So we start with one for loop to determine the row index, so I'll make a loop with int row equals 0, row less than board.getLength 0, row plus plus. Take note of this getLength method, which allows us to specify which dimension of the array we want to know the length of, so index 0 refers to the first dimension. Inside this loop, we can then have another loop with int column starting at 0, while column less than board.getLength 1, column plus plus. So hopefully this makes sense. The outer loop starts with row equal to 0, and then the inner loop begins, so we get a column value of 0, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, after which the inner loop terminates, and so the outer loop gets to run again, and row is increased to 1. This process repeats until row is no longer less than 8, at which point the outer loop terminates. To actually assign to the array, we can say board with an index of row, column, is equal to row plus column mod 2. Remember that the modulus operator will divide the first number by the second number and return the remainder. This operation achieves the result we want. Now, the second type of loop we'll be looking at in this video is the while loop. A while loop simply runs while a certain condition is met. So perhaps we have a bool called doing something, which we set initially to true. We can then say while doing something, and now this loop will run until the doing something bool is set to false. Now, there's nothing a while loop can do that a for loop can't, and vice versa. For example, the following code will make a while loop behave just like a for loop, but it's not as concise as using a for loop. In the same way, if we leave out the initializer and iterator sections of the for loop and just make use of the conditions section, then we've got the same behavior as a while loop, but the syntax is kind of strange with these two extra semicolons. So you can see that both loops serve a specific purpose. In general, we use a for loop when a specific number of iterations is required, and we use a while loop when the number of iterations is unknown or difficult to calculate. We've already seen a practical example of where a for loop is useful, that being assigning values to an array, but you can imagine many more, such as spawning a certain number of enemies into a game, and so on. It's more difficult, however, to imagine cases where you don't know how many times you want a loop to run, but as one concrete example, the first step in some 2D dungeon generation algorithms is to start with a bunch of rectangles for each room, and then to keep nudging them away from one another until they no longer overlap. Obviously, you won't know in advance how many iterations that will take, which is why the while loop is an appropriate choice. We'll see another practical example of while loops in the next episode. The third type of loop is very closely related to the while loop, and it's called the do while loop. How this works is you write the keyword do, followed by the body of the loop, and only after the body do you write the condition. The behavior is exactly the same as a while loop, except that it only checks the condition at the end of each iteration of the loop. As a result, if the condition is false to start with, the code in the loop will still run once before terminating. I found that I very seldom need to use a do while loop, but it's good to know that it exists for those rare occasions. The final type of loop is called the foreach loop, and this is used to iterate over a collection of items, such as an array or a list. We've already seen how a for loop can be used to iterate over a collection, but for situations when you're not assigning to the collection, but simply want to retrieve the values, then the foreach loop is a little bit more concise. Say we have an array of strings called possible names. The syntax for the foreach loop is as follows. First the keyword foreach, and then inside parentheses we declare a variable of the correct type, in this case string, to hold the value. We then indicate that we're looping through each element in the possible names array. If we now print out the name variable, you can see that with each iteration it has been assigned the next value in the array. Now, there are two keywords that you might sometimes find useful when working with loops, and these work the same way for any of the four types of loops. These keywords are continue and break. Continue simply skips one iteration of a loop. So for example, if we have a for loop printing the numbers from 1 to 10, and I write if I equals 5, then continue, then it will skip the rest of the code in the body of the loop for that iteration, and so the output will be 1, 2, 3, 4, continue, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. The break keyword can be used to terminate a loop prematurely. So if I add the lines if I equals 7, then break, then the loop will immediately terminate at that point, and so the output will be 1, 2, 3, 4, continue, 6, break. As an example of when this keyword might be useful, imagine we have some game in which the player attempts to open a locked door. We might loop through each of the slots in the player's inventory to see if that slot contains the correct key for that door. If we find the key, however, there's no need to keep searching, so we can use break to terminate the loop. Alright, to recap, for loops are used when a specific number of iterations is required, whereas while loops are used when the number of iterations is unknown. Do while loops are the same as while loops, but the code inside them will always run at least once, even if the condition is false from the outset. Foreach loops can be used to retrieve elements one by one from a collection. The continue keyword can be used to skip to the next iteration of a loop, and the break keyword can be used to terminate the loop. Alright, that's everything for this episode. Until next time, cheers!